conductor for the lunar module reported that Eagle was go. The swing arm now coming back to its fully retracted position as our countdown continues.
This is the status check of his personnel in the control room. All
T minus 1 minute to launch. The rocket's just disappeared from the Washington Monument. I suspect it's going to come back soon. The sound here is incredible, and especially that there's like 70,000 people between me and the Washington Monument all watching this right now, and another like 70,000 back there. It's pretty amazing.
535 years ago, by the man. Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
5, 6, 5, 4, 1.
Okay, I'm in one of the operations trailers for the locus of what made that incredible projection happen on the Washington Monument. And I have so many questions, we could probably fill like 6 hours of video. I have procedural questions, I have aesthetic questions, but like just at the very beginning, how did you get something so outlandish done? Like, where did the germ of this begin? Didn't that go again? How long ago did you start working on this?
18 months.
Yeah.
We were sitting around the office one day and kind of puzzling over what we could do for the 50th anniversary that would be different and really capture the scope and complexity. And it's supposed to be hard, right? Mm-hmm. It wouldn't be Apollo if it was easy.
So you thought big.
Right.
And Richard, you have a career in which you are repeatedly given completely unique canvases to paint on.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
Is that how you think of it?
Yeah, it's completely. Like, we don't ever make anything for a normal screen shape. So we're always working in kind of weird aspect ratios or whatever else. And this, we've, you know, mapped buildings like Sydney Opera House and Guggenheim in Bilbao. This is kind of simple in some levels because it's just a big square, but also it's like huge and it's a monumental and it's the end of a national, like, park. And how do you tell a story on that? It's kind of the hard thing to do. And these guys, you know, phoning up and saying, we've got this building, it's 500 feet tall, we'd like to do a thing. Being quite coy about what that thing was. I mean, we kind of worked it out.
There's only one 500 foot tall thing in DC.
Another question I have is, how do you know it's gonna work when you can't test it until everything's already in place?
Yeah, well, that's why we're in this literal trailer, and these guys down here have been actually making the show over the last 7 days. I mean, we've made a lot of it and came to site with it, but the detail of it, the finessing of it, has been over the last series of night shifts. So
really?
We've been working 5 to 5 every day. Between midnight and 5, we've been trying things out. The really great thing about these projection shows is that because you can only work at night, we see it at night from, you know, little things going up at 3 in the morning, but we don't hear it. We hear it in the daytime. So the first time that anybody hears it and sees it together is show number one. So, until 9:30 p.m. tonight, we hadn't ever seen and heard it together out loud.
But that's also awesome because you can keep these narrative pieces apart.
Exactly.
And the surprise all happens at once.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So the logistic of this, how many projectors? How many speakers?
It's
a show for 100,000 people.
Yeah, it's 24 30,000 lumen projectors at the base of the monument. Another 8 30Ks up on the mall. Pretty complicated media server. Big sound rig, huge LED wall clock, and then I think it's something like 15,000 feet of fiber across this site, keeping everything together and in time, and then amazing crew and team of people like around this space who are driving us around in golf buggies and trying to keep us working in 100 degree heat out there, which has been part of a challenge this week particularly.
Imagine, and you were also talking as we came up in the dark to say hello to you and meet you for the first time that there was stuff about Shake, like, you're still refining this program.
Yeah, we were the rocket launch sequence. Nick, as our lead designer over here, was working up until about 5 this morning on just the detail of how much, because we wanted to get that sense of energy, and with the, you know, obviously we're not, the projection is not ever actually leaving the monument, so how do you get the sense of it being this sort of ball of energy? Mm-hmm. So we did a couple of things. We did the countdown clock switches quickly to height and feet, so that there's just numbers spinning super fast as it's rising up. And then the music and the sound effect, we got a pretty huge run from there. And then we just give it a little bit of hand shake.
So the launch itself was remarkable for that, the feeling of restraint being pulled against until the rocket takes off. And then you do all this incredible storytelling about the entire Apollo program. And then there's that splashdown image, which for me felt like one of the more remarkable bits of stagecraft, because at the point at which I'm looking at the command module coming through the edge of our atmosphere and the flames shooting off of it, that's when I forgot that I was in the middle of the mall looking at the monument. I was just watching something fall out of the sky, and it wasn't even, the fact that it wasn't changing to my orientation didn't matter. I watched that sort of thing on television all the time. I'm curious about what might have been the thing that surprised you the most at how well it worked once you got to see it up on the monument.
I mean, the texture of the moon was pretty astonishing for me. We hoped it would work as well as it did. There's always a risk when you project on a building that is relatively flat in color.
Yeah.
You put a big white rock on it and it just looks like a big white block and disappears from being a building again. So something with that amount of detail in, we wanted to make sure we got the super detail and the super fine shadows and the texture of the moon onto the monument and don't lose it in the bricks. So it's a real sort of finessing of it really to make it work. But that was that pullback from the moon where we start with the boots and pull all the way back and then see the CSM whooshing past us, and it's from all the splashdown.
1969, humans walked on the moon for the first time. Hundreds of thousands of Americans worked together for this moment.
Katie, I'm curious what it was like to watch it for the first time after all the planning and logistics, and I'm sure behind the scenes negotiations that are probably way weirder than we'll ever know. What was it like to finally see it?
I mean, I think surreal doesn't begin to describe it. It was just kind of crazy, but Nick and I shared this incredible moment where we just watched the rocket on the monument for about 5 minutes in silence, which is probably the most we've ever sat in silence together before, so that was awesome. But what I've been most impressed by, Richard, when we started this, you said black is really hard to project, and you nailed it. I have no idea how you did it, but you got the black sky so perfectly. So that was awesome.
Well, there's so much more to go over, but it's literally 1 a.m. You guys are trying to pack up. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk
so
to us. It is such an incredible achievement, you guys.
Thank you.
It was so moving, and oh my God, thank you. Thank you for making the time, and thank you for the
Station 35 feet, and looking good, down and half. Roger. You take it in the station, Roger.